Well, we're ready.
So, do you want to introduce?
Yeah, I'd like to say thank you, Ed, for agreeing to have us visit the store today. It's August 15th of 2014 in Edmonton. You have a lot of knowledge of history of Gascony County, so we're very pleased to have you share with us some of the stories of the town of Drake and your family and this wonderful store building.
Well, when we had the meeting up at the church, I felt like I should cover more of Drake than the building here. Today, I don't know, I'd rather just talk about the store.
That's fine, absolutely. Tell us a little bit about yourself, like when you were born and a little bit of your family. You have a long history.
I don't have to say how I went the year I was born.
You can leave that part out if you want to. On the other hand, you can be proud of me. You look so good.
That's what my sister said. Everybody thought she was so good. She didn't want anybody to know she was going to be 80 years old. But then, when everybody found out that she was 80, they said, my gosh, you look great for 80. So then she wanted everybody to know that she was 80 years old.
Well, tell us about yourself, whatever you're comfortable sharing.
Well, but of course, both of us, my sister and I, both were born, I mean, we were born over in the house across the road. Mm-hmm. And it was interesting growing up in this place because, you know, we knew everybody. The store was here, and it just became a part of your life, and it was, you know, worth sharing now for people to know about it and everything. So, and I'm glad you picked up on a lot of these things, these pictures and things that are really very worthwhile. We almost have a period here where we can just say, well, this was the first one, this was the second.
Well, we can just start out with the chronology, but at first, if you don't mind, can you tell us, like, when your family first came, when did the Langenbergs first come to Gascony County?
Oh, that was, I mean, you'd have to go back to, there are two different families, and the one came in, let's see, that was in early, about 1850.
Okay.
And then the next one came around in about 1856.
Okay.
And see, one was from my grandfather's family, and the other Langenberg was my grandmother's family, because her grandfather, her mother's father, was actually a Langenberg. And so they came over from Germany, and then, of course, my grandfather's father and his family came over then later. So you had two different families. And
with the same last name.
With the same last name. Mm-hmm. But I actually get my name from my grandfather's side, whereas my grandmother's, you know, that's not where I get my name from. I like her name from.
Okay, sure, yeah.
So we always enjoy, and that's that picture over at the house that you or Lois are going. You can take a look sometime.
Yes, do we want to hang it and share that? Very, very definitely. So.
Well, that was from my grandmother's family. Her that was a brother to her mother.
Okay.
And so you know that it's kind of interesting because you all of a sudden find out that you don't really realize that so many people are related to you. And sometimes you want to probably just say, well, we'll see how this one goes, you know, and if it's worthwhile, I will claim them, otherwise not.
So a long history here then, going back to the 1850s.
Oh, yes.
Drake would have been on the map, but as Lee's Crossing then, correct?
But like my grandmother, Langenberg, she actually was born here.
Okay.
So, you know, her family had been here for some time. So it's interesting that they had been here for so many years. And my grandfather was born here also, the Langenberg.
And right near this area?
Yeah,
right?
Well, on the way to Owensville.
On the way to Owensville, okay.
Down to Second Creek.
Okay.
And it was interesting to have the family all around here. There were people like Alterheides.
Yes.
Well, great-grandfather, Nebal, had two daughters, and one married a Langenberg and one married an Oftrahyde.
Okay.
So there were five Oftrahyde brothers. One of them was a doctor, and he was a doctor here in Drake.
Oh.
So it, and, no, there were six brothers. And so the obituary of my grandfather, when he, you know, he's laid out for the funeral, his pallbearers were the six cousins. The six Oftrahyde cousins.
Yeah, okay.
So, so we had plenty of people around.
And so when did your family first come to the town, what is now Drake?
Well, they grew up, my dad and his sister were born down, say, where the Oftrahydes live on Second Creek.
Okay.
You know, you go down the hill and you turn
right
to the right. And they moved here then about, I guess at the time when my dad was probably about two.
Okay.
And they actually had bought the store at that time, and they lived above the store. So then later, the Williams, the one who had the telephone line and telegraph, he had bought property across the road from the grocers and had built that the house over there.
The house that you currently live in?
Right.
Okay.
So that was our introduction to Drake, I guess, as far as we were concerned, because when we were born, they lived over across the road.
So your whole life until you went away from Drake was here in Drake?
In Drake,
across
the road.
So you have lots of good stories. Yeah, lots of people you know.
Well, it was interesting because you knew all these people, and you knew the ins and outs of them. People would, you know, like this one girl had, she was bleeding to death, you know. And they came here because they had an old car and they couldn't get, you know, to the doctor. And so my dad just drops everything and takes him into to Gerald, to the doctor. And that's just the way life was here, though, because you were always really doing things for other people.
Way more of it should be.
But they, in turn, you know, were good to us too, because they were customers.
Yeah. Codependent.
Yeah. So that's sort of the way life went. After they bought the house over there, my dad and mother were married in 25, and they were going to live in the house, and my grandparents were going to move upstairs above the store. But then that was in October when they were married, and in November my grandfather died, and so that then my parents just moved into the house, and my grandmother continued living with them.
Okay.
So that was, and then different people lived upstairs above the store. You asked about some pictures there.
Yes.
That relates back to.
This goes back to your presentation in April, and you generously shared your photo album, some of which I reproduced here and we'll talk about in a minute. But
the people here, you had some pictures.
Yes, some pictures of individuals that I didn't know who they
were. Well, this man was Ernst Willemann.
We'll put that up here so Jim could see who we're speaking of.
Okay.
And he was from Herman,
okay,
and from a large family, and of course they couldn't support him. So he came here to work for my grandfather, and continued living here all his life.
So did he live upstairs then?
He had his room at the head of the stairs. That was always Ernst's room, and of course
Ernst Willemann. All right.
And so they. You know, he lived here just as a person, you know, part of the family, because he ate across the street and
At your home?
At home.
And, okay.
And, you know, they did all his laundry and all this. And so.
Did he work in the store then, or did
no, he was
here?
No, he was really in charge of the farm.
Okay.
See, they had a farm going here, too. All that land that went through here was part of the farm.
Okay.
And then the big, there was a big barn up here, and mm-hmm. the machine shed, and there was a hog house, and there was a chicken house. And
now, did they sell that produce
no,
here? Or
no,
that was just for
no,
your family?
No, that was just okay. the family. Because, okay. you know, at that time, you more or less had to have your own, you had to be self-sufficient, I guess.
Yeah.
And, but these other people, I knew, that's my dad, Rick Ernst, and this is Leroy Gross, who lived up the road here.
So this is your dad and Ernst and Leroy Gross. A picture with the dog and the...
That's Ernst.
Okay. He's out hunting there, it looks
yeah.
like.
See, these are different times. This is, he's fairly young.
Young in that picture, yeah.
But he was only about, he was only about 15 or 16 when he came here.
Hmm.
Young you know,
man.
They were the kids.
Yeah, you said they couldn't keep yeah. in family, so he'd be moved out. Now, so then who are these other gentlemen?
Well, this is Fritz.
Fritz, okay.
They call him Deutsche Fritz.
Deutsche Fritz, okay.
Because his name was Fritz Helmut Hauser.
Well, that's a good one. Okay.
And Fritz was really, in later years, he had a farm on Kettleman Road, mm-hmm. off of 19,
yep.
and that's where he farmed. But he would come here to the store and buy things and everything. And then later, we would go over and get him every Tuesday and Friday. That's when the truck would go into St. Louis, and so he would be around here then to cut grass and
But he lived on his farm. He didn't live upstairs.
No, no,
okay.
No.
Okay. Well,
and we always laughed because you knew Fritz was around when he would sneeze because you could hear him all over Drake. And he was married to Anna. But they lived over on Breakmeyer Road. Her maiden name was Breakmeyer.
Okay.
We call it Brockemeyer.
Okay.
But it's pronounced Breakmeyer.
Okay.
Now. The A is an R that you say Brockemeyer.
Well, let's look at the store pictures then, because that kind of puts it in context. I think that's all of the individual pictures, and I've got those enlarged here if you'd like to do that and tell us a little bit about the origination of the store. I think this is the first one, right?
Yeah. And see, you see here the man who built the store was Caspar Riebe.
Okay.
Now, you had a picture a while ago of the original store.
Yes.
There. Now that also was built, that was Caspar Riebe's store.
Okay, and where was that located?
That was across the road over here.
Okay, like where the sheds are now.
Yeah.
Okay.
And in addition to that was a doctor's office, and that happened to be Dr. Tainter. And
okay.
that was a great grandson, father of George Tainter, who lives over on Highway 19,
okay.
or his grandson, who rents a house from me over here.
Still a small community.
Yeah.
Okay.
So anyway, that was the first store.
The first store building.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
And then
this was built.
They built this in 1878.
And the town got named, as I recall, for the senator, Drake, in 1865 or 67 when the post office came.
Right.
Okay. Okay.
So this was quite an
huge
building though, because you go down in the basement and you know the stone walls and. It has a brick floor.
Oh, wow.
And
maybe we'll need to take a peek at that.
And then there was this pulley out here so they could hoist things up from the ground floor up to the and store on the third floor.
Now you mentioned that Ernst had his room on the second floor top of the stairs. So was the third floor all storage and the second floor was all a dwelling
unit? Yeah, really. Okay. It would have been.
Okay.
But there were, this was an interesting place on the third floor because they never threw anything away.
Okay.
You know, so anything that was discarded would go up to the third floor.
So
we had a lot of great things, you know, that. And one, I don't know whether you noticed over at the house, there's a they call it tin on lithium. I mean, it's a lithium wrap on tin. It's a big picture like this. And it was for grape nuts.
I saw that, yes. Okay. Yeah.
Fritz, the one who was there.
Yeah.
We do cleaning out, you know, when he was here. And a lot of times he would put stuff aside, you know, and he said, well, I'll take that if you don't want it. So that was one of the things
that Fritz took.
Fritz took. And it was always in their house, and I could go over there and I could see it, you know, and I thought, gosh, why didn't I give that to him? Well, then in later years,
yeah,
you know, we were hauling all that stuff over there, and in later years, we were hauling everything back.
Well, you had Fritz to hold it for you.
Exactly. He was good.
So that was all stored up on the third floor.
A lot of those things would be, and a lot of old jugs and different things and what we have up here. Nothing to guess it. But anyway, that was.
So how many rooms are on the second floor then?
Well, there's the one above here, and then there are two in the front and two in the back.
Okay.
And then there's one over on that side. So actually, there are
six rooms.
Six rooms.
Well, you said the whole family intended to live there. It did live there for a while, so it would make sense.
But we always said that was Ernst's room above here. So.
Well, that makes sense. And so obviously, the post office was here as well.
Yeah.
Okay.
So, and then this, let me see.
I think that's the next one, because that's got the photographers.
Yeah. You see this building here, that's still the old store building that you had back there.
Oh, okay. So. This building here.
Uh-huh.
All right. Because it's across the road. All right. Obviously, teams of horses, and at this point, there's no balcony or anything, just the overhang.
No, that's the way it was originally built. It was, you would say it's more federal design,
mm-hmm.
you know, because it's very plain.
Very symmetrical.
And then later, you can tell then when my grandfather bought it, because just like here, you have the wooden shutters, louvered shutters.
Mm-hmm.
So this was probably the next picture.
Okay.
And this is after Casparipi had sold it to,
Simon name?
Simon Baker.
Mm-hmm.
See, he's the one who had the store in Bay.
Yes, I remember that, okay.
But his son-in-law was, I can't see the name. That's all right. His son-in-law was married to, like, Leroy's Gross's mother, and so they lived upstairs here, and then this is a
because Simon lived over in Bay, right?
He owned it, but it was managed then by the son-in-law.
Okay.
Sutter was their name.
Sutter.
Yeah,
okay.
Simon Sutter, and then this little building was kind of a mystery. But it's a photograph gallery
mm-hmm.
called New York Photograph Gallery. Now this building, it's not really a building. It's a canvas wall, you know, mm-hmm. canvas walls. And they actually did have a photography gallery there.
Were they actually, you know, taking pictures there?
Yeah,
were they,
So
you could come in and get your portrait taken.
Right. We have a lot of old pictures over at the house, and they'll mention this gallery.
Oh, okay.
So that's where it came
from. So it wasn't just a traveling thing there for a few weeks. That was set up for some period of time.
Probably so, yeah. Because okay. I never could find out anything from anybody about it. Mm-hmm. I always thought maybe I'd find something in the newspaper, you know, the mm-hmm. permanent paper, about a photographer being in.
Coming like to Drake and asking if he's available and that kind of thing.
But the other thing is that this was the first chance we had to see this building here.
Okay.
And that supposedly was put up about the same year as the store.
Okay, so 1870.
1870. And that was done by Holbein. That would have been Grandma Langenberg's uncle.
Okay.
And he had a wagon shop there.
Oh.
A blacksmith shop. And later they moved back to St. Louis. And one of the Langenbergs, August Langenberg, one of the brothers, mm-hmm. took that over.
Now, is that building still there, or is it gone?
That was the building then that Dr. Osterheide bought mm-hmm. and had his shop,
medical practice.
Uh-huh. Yeah. And see, they changed a lot of that then. They took off these double chimneys and
that's
stuff.
Very German, like you see in Herman. Yeah.
So, and then that's the building that the Historical Society had bought.
Oh.
They were going to restore it.
Yes.
And then they felt that it was, you know, they couldn't do it. And so then later, people bought it and just trashed it. And you have a picture, I think, of that.
Yeah, I think there's an article here.
County.
This one?
Yeah, that's it. There's the house. And see, the county then bought it and they just burned it down.
What a shame.
But this would have been that house.
You know. Okay, so
you
you're
can
right,
see
yeah.
that. See, there are no chimneys there, but you can see where
there's not a raised parapet.
There,
there
had
is,
been,
yeah.
But there had been two
extensions on it.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So that really dates back then. 1870.
Yeah.
It was no longer there. Okay.
But I always thought, how do they keep, you know, like they make fences, real fences,
mm-hmm.
but how do they keep small animals or something in it? But you can see here how close they put these like rails together.
Yeah, as opposed to here's a plank fence.
Yeah.
And, although that's pretty low to the ground too.
But well,
yeah,
usually,
these are like 15 individual timbers across there. Look at all the horses loading up here.
Yeah, well look at all the...
there's what, spinning wheels? Or is that
saddles
wagon wheels?
And all that stuff here. You
need a magnifying glass.
So then after this,
mm-hmm.
let's see.
Now we have those other two pictures too. By chance, is it one of these?
Yeah, this one would come in probably about this after Grandpa had it. And she said they added the louvered shutters,
mm-hmm.
and they actually had put the porch up here, which
yes.
is not on here.
So this is.
So this would be about 19.
Well, this looks like the cars will give you some idea.
Well, wait a minute, though. Where's my? Oh, here, he's holding the teeth. So that would be about 1987?
That's your father?
Yeah, that's my dad.
Okay.
And so the one with the beard, that's my grandfather.
Oh, my
God. And that's my grandmother and my aunt.
Because at that point in time, they lived up here.
Yeah.
Those would be your grandparents.
Yeah.
Okay. But he's only like 8 or 9 years old.
This photo was made for that history of that history book that they put out
mm-hmm.
in Gascony County.
Okay.
Back in 1910, I guess it was.
Okay.
So that's where this...
they took the image for that reason.
Right. And I'm not sure that this one would... No. No, I think that was made by...
Now
that was done by Schuster.
This is... There's obviously a telephone pole. Here. So maybe, tell
no,
us.
That's a telegraph pole.
A telegraph pole?
Telegraph, tell us about that.
Telegraph was here first.
Okay.
And that was put in by, was really managed and everything, by this Mr. Williams.
Okay. Who built the house?
Who built the house. And see, his wife was the, she ran the switchboard, but they had different ones. At first, this the office was in here, or the switchboard, or whatever you call it, for the telegraph line, was in the store. And then later they moved it over to the house.
Now, did they ever have, like, a stage, or did they have any sort of regular transportation other than private?
No.
No, so there, this wasn't like a stop?
No.
Anything? Mm-hmm. Okay.
No, but it was a telegraph line.
It went from...
And that followed the old state road
from
St. Louis to Jeff City.
Okay. So that's a very early road.
Yeah.
Was there a telegraph that went to Herman, went north or south?
No, not until the telephone came in did they have the connection between Herman.
Okay.
And of course, the old cars on there, mm-hmm. I think that's my grandfather's prize team.
Well, sure, you and put then, the prize team out front.
Then you had these two old cars,
yeah.
And one of them belonged to Mr. Schauff. Okay. He's the man who built the mill over here.
Okay.
And the other one was my grandfather's, probably. And the thing is that there was always like a one-upmanship between the two of them.
Okay.
You know, like if one of them got something, the other one had to get it also.
Well, they could park right across the street
yeah.
from one another
and
show their vehicles.
At,
yeah.
Look
what I got. Yeah.
So that was, see, that would have been like 1910. Then.
That shows the old, mill there, right?
The old mill was built in 1895. Well, that's back then. And all of these have the louvered shutters on them, so that means that that came after.
Came afterwards. And you can see the telegraph line. There's more poles in this one. So that's the... Did the state road go literally right next to...
No, the state road went between the house and the mill and the store.
Just like the little road does today.
Yeah.
That was the state road.
Yeah.
Okay.
And where it was EZ, that's the state road.
Okay. This would have been a busy place.
Yeah, because you had the, also going north and south,
mm-hmm.
was the Iron Road. Mm-hmm. This was the Iron Road out here.
And when was it paved? This was obviously still, at this point, still just like a gravel road or a dirt road.
Oh, I've got that from one of those things, but I, actually, it was paved from here to Herman in the 30s, I guess, late 30s.
Wow, that's early, okay.
I mean, no, probably early 30s. Because that was one of the things, see, they put Highway 50
mm-hmm.
through here. And that was one of the deals, I think, to like to get a road, a paved road. They were supposed to connect all the different towns by a paved road. And that's why 19 came off of 50 and was built from here to Herman.
Okay.
And you go off of 50 at Rosebud, that was Highway 28, and that was a paved road into Owensville. But that's as far as it would go.
Oh, so, but it did interconnect those smaller communities
to a
cross.
Like Owensville and Herman mm-hmm. being the main towns in mm-hmm. Gascony County, I guess. So they built that. So that was, let's see what happened then after that.
Well then, when would the, this image of this car race, since you're talking about paved roads.
That's one I don't know. We think this is about 1960.
Okay.
So, you know, this was not a paved road that these cars were going on. And they were racing to Herman. All of these. Can you imagine how many flat tires they must have had? Because look, that's just almost unbelievable. But the other thing that always impressed me with old pictures like this is look how well dressed those people are. They all have suits.
And hats.
Hats.
Now, it's obviously in cooler weather. There's no leaves on the trees.
Yeah.
So, you know, that would maybe help with some of it. But you're right. They all do have their full suits on. It looks like they have flags affixed to their cars. And I'm not sure I can read with the banners.
Well, there was some celebration in Herman that this was promoting.
I don't know. Might have been 100th anniversary or something. Who knows?
I don't know.
That'd be 1936, though. So this, I don't know if these cars are...
No, I think that was like... No, that would have been before.
There was a 75th anniversary, too. That would have been 25 years sooner. Maybe that's what it is. They regularly had anniversaries. Well, in any event, they had quite a race.
Yeah.
And they...
See, and the house is over there. If they... And you still see the
telegraph poles. And obviously the porch is on it, so it's after your grandfather had done improvements.
Well, the windows are all
with the shutters. Now you have an interesting shutter door on the front too. Is that big shutter door, enclosing door, always been on there from the very beginning, or is that something your grandfather added?
No. That was put on, I guess, maybe by... It depends on when that was when the post office came in.
Okay.
And the government required you to have, to be able to secure all the lower entries. So there were big shutters that went on these windows.
Mm-hmm.
And also then these shutter doors.
So like a solid panel
mm-hmm.
shutter.
Yeah, it was a solid panel shutter.
I wonder if that's why Bay has solid panel shutters. Because it would have been a post office, too.
Yeah, but I think those shutters were there before.
Okay.
You know, that's an older building than this one.
Okay. I just remember they had unique, heavy shutters, Okay. Well, I didn't know it was a postal requirement.
Yeah, that's why you had these solid shutters. And all of these windows... Like these, mm-hmm. the big ones were in threes.
Oh,
so you
separate
had one closed, and then one folded, say back, mm-hmm. and then back.
Oh.
So you had
in sections, and they kind of like retracted back.
And there are little knobs in there that you would screw into the from this side
mm-hmm.
into the shutter. So, you know, it was locked, didn't you?
And then you could close the windows?
No. Well, no, that was then the shutter was closed.
Okay.
And was locked.
Okay.
We can't go there now. But
so you can show us that. That would be great.
Yeah.
Yeah, okay.
Because it's just a little, I can see it from here, but you wouldn't be able to make it out. That when you close the shutter,
mm-hmm.
There's on the inside there was like a screw.
Okay.
And you'd screw that then in through the outside shutter.
And hold it tight.
And that you couldn't put that back then.
Okay.
And the other two shutters, one would come over, fold out, and then fold in, and there would be a knob on that one too.
So the store has always had the post office since the beginning, right?
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
And where would that have been located here in the store?
In the back, there was a section of
okay.
where there was like an office. And then that was also the post office.
Okay.
So then, I don't know what year post office closed and then moved. You moved to Tonesville. But that was back in the late 30s, I think.
When it moved.
Mm-hmm. But they used to have, you know, like service from, they would come through here and they'd stop here and then they'd go on to Herman. So you had, you know, that one day service.
Poor Kenny.
I just remember I ran across some papers and of it.
Uh-huh.
And it was from the funeral home in Bloomer's funeral home in Herman. Mm-hmm. And this was coming from Herman. And there was a letter from Bloomer's funeral home asking my dad to be an honorary pallbearer at Mr. Kierhofer's funeral. You know, and they would like an immediate reply. Well, he would write this out then, and on their way back to Herman, they stopped.
And picked it up.
You know, you had one day's service.
That's great.
You don't have that today, I guess.
Huh? No, that's true. So what sort of things would you have had in the store at that point? Like when your grandfather had the store, what all kind of merchandise did
they have? They had everything.
And everything.
See, the main thing, there was a counter here that they'd wait on people.
Mm-hmm.
But all these shelves went up almost to the ceiling.
And these are the original shelves, or just there were shelves that went all the way to the ceiling?
Yeah, they were taken off. Because, well, they were chopped off and everything. So these were put in then to more or less go along with the others all the way around. But there was a meat counter here that I remember.
Mm-hmm.
And there was, oh, and there was a bar in here.
A bar?
Mm-hmm. There was a bar in the back here with a big cooler for beer and soda. And the bar went from about this chair all the way over to that other counter.
And the door takes you down to the cellar?
To the bar.
Okay.
But, no, that was a big thing because they, you know, people would stop here on their way back from work or something.
Mm-hmm.
They'd all meet in here and have a beer.
Hence Jim's stories.
Yeah.
About what was going on as they sat over the beer.
No, but you see that? Those, some of those big mugs in the center.
Yes, right in the middle,
yeah.
Right below the flag.
Uh-huh. And you see in the back of there, there's a yellow tray.
Yes.
Capital beer.
Yes.
Well, that was made in Jefferson City, and that was the main
beer
on draft in here at that time.
Like current microbreweries, only that was just a local craft beer.
That was until Prohibition came, and then that was all ended.
So you said they didn't happen to have any behind the counter during Prohibition? They,
no.
They towed the line pretty strictly?
No, I think they did sell a lot of sugar, though, too. But by the home brew. And
they sold a lot of malt and they sold a lot of other things. Oh, my.
But that was, and then the counter was here, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
And I remember, like, one of those counters was, well, in the back there, that was tobacco and cigarettes.
Okay.
And that was tobacco in that case. You know, there are a lot of different kinds of chewing tobacco, different brands.
Mm-hmm.
And so you had all of them. And there was candy. And then in the middle, they had racks, you know, for more vegetables, more groceries and things.
Okay.
And then over there was all piece goods and millinery, dry goods.
Okay.
And then they had men, or the shirts and tie shirts and overalls and shoes. And back there is hardware and some more kitchenware and stuff like that.
So they just had a mini department store.
Yeah, it was really everything. And then out there was the feed store.
On the part that's the attachment, the lean-to, that's shown.
And the
one of these pictures.
But the other more recent one, probably.
They're starting to show
like
there.
Hair,
yeah. Okay.
So that, and then of course they did all kinds of they had fertilizer and. Then they bought chickens and eggs and cream.
Now, did they do that on a barter? Were they buying it, paying it, and then
came in? No, you'd pay what the rate, you know, what the egg prices. We would get the paper from St. Louis every day.
Mm-hmm.
That would have the egg prices.
One day service again.
Egg prices. Well, that was kind of interesting here too, because talking about one day service, there was a Missouri Pacific bus line.
Oh, okay.
That came from St. Louis, followed Highway 50.
Okay.
Not, you know, the Greyhound followed 66, but Missouri Pacific followed Highway 50 to Jefferson City.
Okay.
And they used to pick up people here, and they would come down off of 50 and turn here, and if the flag was out, they'd stop. Otherwise, they'd go on.
And what year, about when would that have been?
Oh, that was all during the war.
Okay.
They used to get back at that time, I think, the Missouri Pacific had buses running almost every hour.
Every hour?
Yeah.
That's just hard to even imagine today.
I know, but...
I guess you had gas rationing.
Well,
so
you had gas rationing and tires and everything.
Thing?
And so people had to ride public transportation. And that was, I remember, you know, like going to St. Louis with my mother, Christmas shopping or something. And I would stand up all the way, probably. I mean, it would be that crowded.
But because they were every hour, you could go in the morning, and yet you could come home yet that evening.
Come home that afternoon, yeah.
That's just unbelievable.
But the thing is, though, that as busy, you know, they were busy. They just, like, you'd stand up all the way into St. Louis.
Hard to even conceive of.
I mean,
today.
I had to do that because my mother told me I had to.
Because you were a gentleman. You were a young boy.
I was a kid,
stand.
You know,
I
could stand up.
Yeah. And when did that service end? Did it just gradually dwindle away to less frequent?
Well, it was still going at the time when we sold the store, so I don't really know when.
And you sold the store when? Your
father? In 50.
Okay. Your father sold the store.
No, my mother did.
Your father
had died.
Oh, okay.
So that was no, it was, you know, when times like that, I guess you just do anything you have to.
I guess so.
Because I always remember seeing they were dealing with ration books, you know, for tires and gas. Food and shoes and what else? Most, you know,
anything that was a necessity that could be used for war, I suppose.
Yeah.
And they were collecting iron and other things, so.
But you couldn't get things like pet milk. We had this one man in some kind of illness, and we always had to save pet milk for him. We knew he was sick. And
he needed it.
He needed it, and of course, that government doesn't say, "Yeah, we look the other way, and you can do it."
He had to save up his coupons or others had to contribute theirs in order to cover for him.
Right. So, but you just did that too. See, this was like in the back here.
So this is taken in the store.
Uh-huh. And they used to decorate for Christmas.
Streamers and things. Okay. So is your dad, your mom?
That's my dad, my aunt.
Your aunt, okay.
And he was that's Vincent Blackmore. He was the flower salesman. Flower, I mean.
As in
red flower.
Red flower.
Yeah.
Okay. And do you know the other gentleman in the picture? They're all still
I don't
quite
know
the
name. I know this man here was Mr. Maupin, and he was the sheriff.
Oh.
Gascony County. And he was a clay man. And then in back here, I think, was Mr. Colley. And this dapper gentleman was, he sold Peter Hopman cigars.
Really? What a memory you have for things, Ed. Peter Hopman cigars.
H-A-U-P-T.
Oh, I gotcha. Hopman.
Yeah.
Hopman. And it looks like, is this the meat cone? It's like almost like a scale.
Yeah, that's a scale. Well, that was on top of the meat.
So that's right along here then?
Mm-hmm. Right where you're standing.
Oh, amazing. And then this would show all those going all the way up to the ceiling.
Yeah.
Because you've kind of got cans of things.
Well, see those shelves sort of came out.
Projected out further.
Projected out further.
Oh, yes, I see that. Yeah, they project out further right there.
In the same way over there. It was all along that line. And there was a track, though, over there with a ladder that you could, you know, get everything off the top shelves.
Well, you have to, I guess. To, looks like there's some sort of decoration or thing or something at the top. And 5 cent, maybe sodas or something?
No, those swing pies.
Oh, what's a swing pie?
Oh, I didn't know they've been around for a long time. They're still around, I think. Aren't they, Jim?
I don't know.
No swing pies.
I don't know.
I don't know swing pies, but it might be something just lovely. Okay, so it's a, it's some sort of a...
It's like a cookie with icing on it or something.
Oh, okay. Well, they were obviously at 5 cents. So you got it must have been popular. There's quite a quantity, or they just got it for delivery. So it looks sort of like a, appears sort of like a crest or something. Maybe it's decoration.
I think it's some kind of decoration. You see,
holidays.
See here they have butterflies all over here.
Oh, yeah. Oh, you're right. It's like
a... Oh, there's Peter Hopman cigars.
Yeah. Product placement. Even back then, he's got it prominently displayed for the photographs with the labels facing it. He's a good salesman. That's amazing. So when did the gas pumps, we have a picture here where there's gas pumps in front, when did they get installed?
Well,
let's see this one clear down here.
Probably in about the 30s, I guess.
Because you said you had two different kinds, right?
Yeah. There's White Crown and Red Crown.
Red Crown.
And those things are worth a fortune today if you could find those.
Really?
They're about this big around. Very fragile, though. Kids love to do their meat chews
on them. Oh, no. And then this, you said, was an MFA pump further down?
Yeah. And you see, on the side of the store here, it's kind of, you can't really see that, but there was a grape arbor that ran all
the way. Oh, well, you can see it all the way back down here. Yeah. Did they make any wine here, or was that just...
I think they did. I don't know. They never did say. I think they made some homebrew product.
And here you can see these are those solid panel shutters on the lower level like you were discussing.
Yeah, see, this are smaller windows on the side, so there were only two of those.
And here's the three lights of the windows in the front that you're describing. Well, maybe at this point the post office had moved, so they took them off the front, because the big doors aren't on here, on the front doors either. Now, you mentioned there was a Coke display clear up there. It looks like it's as tall as that door.
It is, yeah. And there was tin, you know, it's like a lithic wrap on tin. Mm-hmm. And that's the same way as this little one here. That was tin.
And that's on the telegraph lines.
Yeah.
And there's another Coke sign over here. So the feed stores, all of this, and this little bit, all the mercantile, and was anybody living upstairs at this point?
I'm not sure.
Other than Ernst?
Well, there were different ones, because in addition to Ernst, before that, there were two or three were made into bedrooms. And those were for men who worked in the store and also on the corner. And of course they would all eat over at the house. Mm-hmm. So they fed everybody there. Mm-hmm. And then usually the first two rooms, there were people living there, you know, like family.
Oh, okay.
Like husband and wife, and I don't know if they would have any child.
Well, it would have been a housing need.
I know they, when they put the highway, they built the highway 50, the man who was manager of the construction crew through this area, he and his wife lived up there, and their two daughters.
Well, that would make sense.
Yeah. His nun was there, Amy. Isn't that funny? I remember Geraldine and Maxine. Two girls' names. But that, and I don't remember, I don't know why I would know that, because that, they left the day after I was born.
Really? Well, your parents must have talked about it then or something. Maybe they were memorable.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. No, my sister, she remembered them. They used to play with them.
So they were friends. Yeah.
But the reason they were delayed a day, because that Mrs. Nunn just knew that I was going to be born the next day.
And she didn't want to leave?
And she didn't want to leave. She wanted to see that baby.
Well, she's been here throughout all of your development. So. Oh, my.
No, that's what Mother always said. The nuns couldn't leave because Mrs. Nunn had to see that baby.
Well, they're important to your family.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But then, too, you know, like when I was born, my sister, she wasn't too confused about that at all.
About
she
you?
Was 6 years older than I was, and she had the run of the mill, you know, for all this time. Now, all of a sudden, she's got competition.
And Mrs. Nunn needed to wait to see.
And it was really worse because my uncle and two of my aunts, they all had children that year. And so here was my sister with three down, another one coming along here.
She had a lot of competition.
She had a lot of competition. I always remember Mother saying that they went to see the one aunt and the new baby. And my sister looked at her on the way home and said, "Well, is Emma going to have one too?" And Mother said, "I think so." I said, "Well, she might as well." So that was all part of life.
Yeah.
But growing up here in Drake was quite an experience because you just had, you know, you knew everybody. We knew people from Herman and from Owensville because they would stop in, you know, they would stop here and on the way home. So it was a nice life. Now this, you had some pictures here
of the mill.
The mill. Yeah. Mm-hmm. The mill was built in 1895.
Yeah, I think this is the first one because it had the team of horses out front. And I think this has the Schaff family.
Schaff.
Okay.
William Schaff was the name. And yeah, see, they don't have the porch on here. Mm-hmm. But it was something new because it was a they were roller mills.
Okay.
And, I mean, it was a roller mill. And that was a new process of grinding flour. The wheat would go through a series of rollers and sifting. And then there'd be another rolling and sifting. And each time they would take off, you know, like a byproduct of it.
Okay.
And sort of using it as hogs or something. Mm-hmm. So it was quite a thing. And then they had, I don't know whether you can see all the wood back here.
Oh, there's a huge pile. Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And that's what provided the steam.
So it's a steam-generated roller.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Okay.
And there's still, over there, there's a shaft that goes all the way the entire length of the building. And there were all these little wheels on each one. That would serve certain things down at the bottom, you know, the grinders and so forth. Because they would have pulleys. Mm-hmm.
And belts that would connect them.
Belts. And then there was the main big wheel was way back here, and of course that connected with the one down in the basement unit. Mm-hmm. And that ran everything. So when I bought that, and Jim's in with me on the store, but I had already bought the mill.
Okay.
was painted, I don't know if I have a picture of it, painted red, white, and blue.
I don't think I saw that. You do have a scrapbook that shows pictures when you bought things. I don't remember seeing one red, white, and blue, but okay, so
well,
red,
anyway,
white, and blue.
It was red, white, and blue.
Uh-huh.
And so I did not want to re-tin that. It was covered with tin also. And I did not want to re-tin it, or I didn't want to paint it red, white, and blue.
Mm-hmm.
So after they started taking off the tin, we found out the weatherboards were still underneath.
And in good shape.
In good shape. A lot of them were. So what we had to do then was to have some of them milled, and otherwise they were in good shape. And then we used a paint that covered painted surfaces and non-painted surfaces, and mm-hmm. so it worked out fine.
Now you restored that in what, the early 1980s, or when was it restored? I'm
let's
trying
see.
To recall.
I guess it was in the 80s.
I remember you hosting, I think you had a historical society event there where you let people come see it at one time.
Okay.
If I remember correctly, it seemed like I came to see it then, when we first moved out.
Yeah.
And that was in the 80s, so.
Yeah, that would have been in the 80s.
And then you guys had it as an antique store too, right?
Well, no, we did. Jim opened one in there just temporarily until we got this one going.
Oh, okay.
Otherwise, that too, we have to get rid of a lot of stuff.
You didn't get that all hauled from Fritz, did you?
No.
Okay.
But this is kind of interesting here. There was a, you don't see that in most of the pictures, but here was a little log house. And that was Leroy Gross's great aunt who lived there.
Oh. So this little building.
Yeah.
Clear over here, yeah.
Yeah, well, that's a little building next
to it. You can see the horizontal elements there.
Yeah.
Yeah. So that was a Gross
mm-hmm.
house. All right. Now, is it in the subsequent picture? We've got another one. Oh, the angle doesn't show it.
No.
It's a different angle.
Yeah.
Although there's another house back there.
Yeah, that one, that's a mystery. I don't know who that is. Because they built the brick house that's over here.
The family that built it?
Yeah, the Schaus.
Schaus, okay.
Now there's Mr. Schaus, the little car.
What was your dad's parked across the street?
Probably so.
But it was still being used as a roller mill, as it had been even back in the day here.
Yeah.
All right. And you said that's like 1890?
This was 1895 when this was built.
Which is about the same time as the house that you live in, right?
No, that was 1897, 8.
Okay, so a little later, okay.
Yeah.
And they would have been maybe living here, but you know, they built the brick house.
Well, the brick house was built at the same time.
As this was
yeah.
built, okay.
I think that's the people who had, I don't know what kind of business they had. But see, the original mill of his, of Schaus, was down on Second Creek.
Oh.
It was a grist mill.
Water driven.
Yeah.
Okay. And so as technology changed, then he moved
then
here,
he moved here
more populous
it
area,
a,
more traffic.
Became a roller mill rather than.
Okay. Oh, do you know how big of a geographic area he would have brought in people from to have, I assume, their wheat ground into flour, and I assume took it home, or did they sell it to him as a finished
No,
product?
I don't really know.
Okay. I have no idea.
But I mean, most every little town had some kind of a mill, I guess, but this was a pretty big area. There had been Bay.
Mm-hmm. There's a mill there, yeah.
And
a big mill in Herman.
Swiss or Stony Hill had a mill.
Mm-hmm.
But that's about it. So you get a Rosebud.
So it covered a pretty good
yeah,
area.
Yeah.
It'd be a day's commitment to get here with it.
No, I have some documents, I don't know, I guess it's not in here, of how much flour was produced at different times.
I think you maybe mentioned it in your talk when you were pulling from the news articles. Yes.
Yeah.
Right, I recall that.
So that, let me see, that was pretty early, I think.
This one? This is when I think you told me once this had livestock pens at that particular point. You were actually holding livestock, but it's obviously after your grandfather bought it because he's got but it doesn't have the canvas pens yet. So.
No, no, that would have been before.
Yeah.
And then, you had a picture here of the.
Oh, this is a good, tell us about the Citizens Hall.
Well, from what I understand, they were going to build, they had an election about putting the courthouse here in Drake.
Mm-hmm.
And, of course, that's the time when Heitzen had given the money, to build a new courthouse. Well, that pretty much swayed the vote. But it still was very close because people from the southern end of the county really voted for it.
Mm-hmm.
Or
for obvious reasons, close.
It's close. So somehow or another, I lost my handkerchief. Somewhere along the line, they decided that they would build a citizen central hall in the central part of the county.
Mm-hmm.
And they could hold their meetings here and even do some of the county work here. So that's how the citizen central hall was built. And the top floor was a big hall. No posts or anything.
Would it be about the same size as like this room, big square?
It was longer.
Okay. There's three windows this way too there. Okay.
I'm just trying to think. Probably it would have been like where that mirror is,
mm-hmm.
back to about where this counter or that case is there.
Well, that's good size.
Yeah, and then there was actually a platform built like for a stage.
Okay. And did they have like dances and meetings?
I don't know if they had dances. I know they had like medicine shows, they call them.
Yeah.
And they would, sell boxes of things. There's a diamond ring in there,
If you buy the box, you get a chance at the diamond ring. Yeah.
I was always so bashful. I was afraid I would get it.
Did you?
And I didn't want to go up and pick it up.
You were bashful?
I was bashful. So anyway, that's the story of this. And then the lower level was Mr. Morey's shop. I guess the old building.
Was that a blacksmith shop?
Yeah. I guess he had the old lower building. And then their house was farther back here.
Well, I think it's interesting how they've got everything around the trees all stands, I suppose because you could tie up to them, but also so you didn't destroy the tree.
Yeah, I think it's 1901 or 2.
Yeah, it is an O. I think you're right.
The interesting part about that is that they built a new church, the church up here, the brick church. That used to be, the Methodist Church was down on Highway 50. Okay. There's a cemetery down there, where that Phoenix Winery is.
Okay, yes, I know where that is.
Okay, that was where the Methodist Church was.
Mm-hmm.
And from what I understand is that they used the wood from that church when they tore that down,
mm-hmm.
to build this building.
Oh. And the brick church here was built at the same time then?
It was built around 1902, I think.
Okay, so because it replaced the one they tore down.
Yeah. And that, they used that when they tore the old store building down.
Oh, yeah, the one we had the picture
of. Mr. Morey, Harvey Moore, built his house out of the wood of that. There.
This old building, mm-hmm. Okay.
So they used everything they could.
That would make perfect sense. And so you had a doctor here? You had a blacksmith here. You had a roller mill here.
Miller.
You had the store here. You had
church.
A church. And you had a women maker. You had the cabinet maker.
The cabinet maker, yeah.
Right? And he also would have done, was he like also an undertaker? I know they built coffins. So did he do any undertaking or the
no.
The production of the coffin?
Mr. Tamar had the old hearse drawn by horses. And like you would, somebody would die, you would go to Wayne Meaner to get the coffin and probably take it home and then do whatever you want to with putting in cloth or something. And then Mr. Katmeyer would come and
collect
the body and take it to wherever they had the funeral. A lot of times they would just have it in homes. And then he would take it to the cemetery, then they would bury it.
Now the cemetery is here in town near the church, or is it over where the old cemetery is?
Well, there's one there, and there's one up here at the new church. But there was left, there was Mr. Tapmeyer, Simon Tapmeyer. Mm-hmm. He was so opposed to their starting a new cemetery up here. And he got up at a meeting or something, and he said that this was supposed to be the onlyest cemetery. So that was, but it wasn't.
So they had two of them.
It was onlyest.
The onlyest cemetery. About what do you have? I mean, if the church was here, it's obviously early 20th century.
Yeah.
He would have been doing this, and if he was still with a team of horses, it's early. Unless he was still using a team.
I think maybe there would have been somebody from Holmesville who would probably have been, I don't know, when they passed the laws up here, they have a mortician.
Versus home preparation.
Yeah.
And all
that. Yeah. So if you're getting into the 1900s, why you're probably getting close to when you would have
a lot of change going on then.
Yeah.
A lot of change.
Yeah.
So what's your best memory of being here at the store? I mean, you've obviously spent many years here. What's some of your most memorable incidents that occurred or things that you...
You know, I don't really think there are any particular ones.
Really?
It was always, you just accepted, you know, that you were here.
So did you work here every day? Did you have a job that you worked at here at the store?
Not always. When I could sneak away, I would work.
And when you snuck away, what did you go to do?
Oh, probably go fishing or something. You know, you had ponds down here and down there. Run around with Kenny Kreitzer, who lived across the lake later. Mm-hmm. Norbert.
Yeah.
So you didn't have to work all the time.
But you sometimes work like behind the counter and waiting on the customer, or restocking.
Restocking, yeah.
Okay.
But I think they really just seemed to have me out of the way.
Now, did your sister work here then, or what did
yeah,
you?
Yeah, she did sometimes too. It was the same thing.
Okay. So she could kind of go get away on occasion too and go do her things.
Yeah. So we, you know, it was one of these things that. You always knew everything was taken care of, so you didn't bother about doing anything.
Yeah. Well, it was safe to go and do all those things, so you probably were out from the time you could get up in the morning till you had to come home.
Oh, you couldn't wait to get up in the morning. That was something you had to do. Exciting. Mm-hmm. And that's just the way life was here.
It sounded like your mom then prepared meals for not only your family, but for those that were staying here? Would that be the case?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, so she served a pretty good size.
Yeah, she had help. You know, mm-hmm. And she had help with us, too. It's Charlie Schlettoff has the white mule.
Yeah.
His mother is still living. Marion, she was Marion Schlettoff, Marion Miller. Mm-hmm. And she always says, you know, I wish you were naming. So, we did have a nanny.
Well, that's great. Well, they were so close, you had to be attended to because people would be at the store.
Well, there was, she was one, and then there was a people lived down here, Schmitz, Emma Schmidt. She was, she'd always come up and say, I wish I knew. So we had two of them.
Two of them, okay.
So, that's nice.
So did they ever have an instance where there was, you know, Jim was telling us the made-up tale about Jesse James, but did they ever have a robbery or is anything ever going on in the Great Depression that might have been like a
big old
body?
They stole a pickup one time from here, but that was... So what?
It just happens. Okay, so nothing particularly...
No.
Because you'd be out here kind of in your...
If there'd be somebody... You know, with accident, you have an accident or something, or maybe you wonder about that. One of the thing I remember though, that could have been quite serious because they got it out, but down 50, they had a forest fire, and it was really burning close up to here. But they got it all out in time because it was a real dry season. Mm-hmm. But that was, I don't really know of anything that, we had a lot of interesting people, you know, that come in here. Mm-hmm. One I remember, his name was Ewald Berger, and he lived with his uncle, Martin Deppy. They lived down ZZ, about 3 or 4 miles, and Ewald liked to show up, and they had a car. Mm-hmm. And they'd be maybe out Rosebud or somebody, a place, and he'd come flying down the road. And of course, if he wouldn't see anybody on the porch or anything, why, he'd probably make the turn normally. But boy, if he'd see somebody on the porch, he would take that turn on two wheels. His poor old uncle, he was just holding on for dear life. No, no, he didn't. Always made it.
He got everybody's attention, huh?
Oh, yeah. But that was... but you always had people like that and interesting people.
How about your grade school teacher? Do you have any memories of your grade school teacher?
Yeah, we, at the time when I was in school, I think we only... Well, we had two teachers, but... The main one was Clara Brenneman was her name. She was from Stony Hill. And she was a great person. I liked her. And she had been, she was crippled.
Oh.
Back in times, I guess, when Franklin Roosevelt, you know, had infantile paralysis. Not, it was later known as polio, which she had. And so she was crippled from that point. She drove a car and everything.
And was this at the little, at the Drake School?
At the Drake School.
Okay, all right.
And
you went to school there through what grade? Then did you move then to Owensville to go to
high school?
First high school?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
So through eighth grade at the Drake School?
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, actually, seventh. I took two grades in 1 year.
You took two grades in 1 year? You went through both seventh and eighth in 1 year?
No, I did fifth and sixth in 1 year.
Fifth and sixth? You were a smart kid. A bashful one, but a smart kid.
So it, no, but it was a lot of fun. You know, you'd ride your bicycle over there, or walk. It was like 2 miles, but that wasn't that far, really.
Today they think that was a great walk.
Yeah. And I forgot about school, that's, but there were, you know, this store actually covered a large area of people, because we go all the way down to, like, where you turn off the bay, but you go where the Remerts lived, and the Gawlers, and those people, they all came to the store here.
Okay.
So that was, you know, that was
a pretty good distance.
Distance, yeah. And if you go this way. Well, we even had a lot of people from Bay, because as I found out later, they were all relatives. All the Hobines and everything. So.
Yeah. Well, doesn't the creek at Bay kind of divide some of that, where it was harder to get across the creek, whether you were on which side?
Well, of it was more the people from on this side.
Okay.
Little Bay area.
Yes, Little Bay, right. Yeah.
Because see, that Little Bay store at one time was a Langford store.
Was it?
Mm-hmm. That was my grandmother's uncle. Okay. Would have been a brother to the one in the picture there at the house.
Oh, okay.
So
it would have been built earlier even than this store building.
Oh, yeah. So, well, let's see.
Do you want to, can we walk around and see a little bit of the building? Would that be possible?
Sure.
Can you show us a little tour of upstairs maybe, or the rest of down here, or if you wanted just a panorama of things?
This was a candy case. Each wedge was for different kinds of bulk candy. So can you see this?
So it rotates to access the other.
Yeah. And it actually was used. We had this made to have it sit on, but it normally would have been on a big counter up here where they waited on people. You know, a lot of these things you see today, the mm-hmm. photographer, or the pictures like that, mm-hmm. they're really worth some money mm-hmm. for the artwork.
For the artwork itself, yeah. Well, they're beautifully done. Those are not faded. They're very crisp looking. Here's one that's got dogs peeking out. It's a postcard that says it's from Greetings. It's in like glitter. Greetings from.
Now this one is very rare.
Oh.
Greetings. No, souvenir of Drake, Missouri. Okay. They were. They had cut the doors down to about half this, or down to that first row. Mm-hmm. And then there was a great big transom above that mm-hmm. for letting air in. And so we went back to the original. This was the original design.
You guys did a great job. This is an exemplary restoration. It shows it as it was. Love the bell.
See, there's a box that fits on the side here. We didn't put it in here. But for dropping letters in.
Oh, mm-hmm. yeah.
And it's a box that fits, just screws on there. It's about so big.
And then clearly you literally bar the door from the inside.
Was the original bar.
Oh, really?
In the store.
So it would have sat like kind of in front of where.
We were talking about the front. Boy, it seems warmer up here, doesn't it? On the top shelf, there's a sack from the Drake Flour Mill, white rose flour. William Schauf, Drake, Missouri, see, he's the one who owned the rolling mill. And the other things are just some odd. That on the end is a needle and bobbin, and it goes around, and there are names of all the sewing machines all the way around.
So there's
an arrow that you turn, and you turn it to your machine, and then open up the thing, and that should be the bobbin or the needle for that mm-hmm. particular machine.
And there's all the beer steins and flasks for the Capital beer that you were telling us about that was served here. And then are the thermometers and things, ones that the store issued,
yeah,
that you shared with us for the display, I
right,
think, for the advertising?
All of the top shelf there, the calendars, that's what they would give away at Christmas. Our plates down here would have a name on it, like Louis Langenberg and Son or something like that.
It looks like there's some fans, too.
And so, the fans.
Yeah.
And matchboxes.
Oh, yeah. Louis Langenberg, I see it on there. General merchandise, Drake Missouri.
See, this one has a striker on it, you know, the...
Oh, the one on the right.
Uh-huh. And then a place to put your old matches.
Discarded matches, mm-hmm, yeah. Didn't want to throw anything away. You use it for something else. Start a fire.
And the bowls down there were from 1927, I think it was.
And it looks like you did some yardsticks, too.
Yeah. A lot of yardsticks. Yeah, that was...
Geocentral, truly.
Oh, yeah.
Communications Central. And this line ran from Drake to Hermann?
At different times.
Okay.
It started from here to Hermann.
And it was like a...
According to that thing, there were actually... There were three places where they had a telephone. Mm-hmm. And one was the central office. One was this... Let's see, one was the hotel. Oh, and one was the newspaper office.
This being in Hermann.
In Hermann.
So three places in Hermann.
Where you
the
had
store
a phone.
Here in Drake. And then you could call from one to the other.
Yeah. And then eventually they put them to Owensville and they put one to Rosebud.
But they had to set poles the whole way from one place to the other.
Yeah.
And raise the capital to create the phone. And that was
It ended up then with Grandpa and Mr. Williams owning the whole kit and caboodle.
And did they end up then selling it at some later time as they started to consolidate the telephone companies?
They sold it to United, which was the telephone service in Hermann for many years.
Okay.
So that was... Mm-hmm. And so then when he died, it was on his estate sale. Mm-hmm. And the problem, though, was that there was the ringer was out of here. This thing, all the magnets.
Oh, yeah.
And also, this section up here.
A bell?
Was gone. It was just a board covering it. So, anyway, then the following week, there was a call from a man in St. Louis, where he's Alton. And he was originally from out here.
Mm-hmm.
And he said that he understood I bought the old switchboard. And he said, I just want to let you know that I have the ringer for that.
Well, that was kind of it.
So he said, I'll be coming out there before too long, so I'll bring it out with me. Well, he not only brought that,
mm-hmm,
but he brought those eight bells up there.
Oh, how nice.
I said, why did you take that out of there? What would you have used it for? And he kind of nodded and he said, are you a fisherman? And he said, oh, yes, but I wouldn't do that. And what they do is that they attach a wire to the magnets, mm-hmm, and then put it in the water,
mm-hmm,
and you crank that and it gives a shock.
Talk.
And it stuns the fish and they float up to the top.
But you wouldn't do that.
But he wouldn't do that.
He thought about doing it. So
But you know, that is really, it's very legitimate. Conservation people,
mm-hmm,
use that same method when they're checking to see how many, you know, when they had to restock a pond.
And see what its current population
what
is.
What the population is.
Yeah. Huh. I didn't know that.
So if you wanted a bottle out of here, you pushed one in, and so it would come up on the other side. One of them would come up on the other side.
And it would refill and replenish the supply.
Yeah, exactly.
Ingenious! Would that have been something like you had behind the counter there when you were talking about?
How do you like the construction.
Yeah, it's not. What?
Like root beer.
But they were made by Coca-Cola?
Uh-huh. Yeah, it's on here, there's soda water and bottling. It's soda water.
But then it's flavored, so they add different things
Coca-Cola
to the
Coca-Cola bottling works. That's what it was. And so that would be like root beer or cream.
Cream, orange soda.
But you so much, and then you could
redeem it like we do for coupons today sometimes.
I like this one as the cream pitcher. It says, to make things right is our delight when we are wrong and you are right. Edwin Langenberg.
That's great. It's a beautiful pattern. And it complements the piece, the souvenir plate, too. Very pretty. Exotic birds and all kinds of fruit. And each year they're a little different.
Done in about 1900. And you can see how long it was used down there where she would put her feet.
Mm-hmm.
It's all worn through.
Oh my heavens. Yeah, it's completely worn through. So you're pulling up the cord and saying, number please, right? And connecting it into their phone, and that physically...
We had this one, brought that in and gave it to me. They found that they had bought a house out here, and they found it up in the attic, and it was a receipt for...
Oh, as partial payment for his phone rental. So this must come from the old...
it's where the electricity was generated. And on those things were those great big wet cell batteries.
My grandfather had those on the farm. Okay. I know what you're talking about, yeah.
That's what those, that chest are.
That's what held those, and you're right, they were just that size and dark green. But I know you've got the perimeter drain, which is typical, but it doesn't look like you have much moisture coming through the walls.
We haven't had much moisture outside either.
Well, not recently.